When Apollo 7 launched in October of 1968, the United States and the Soviet Union were locked in a space race. However, it had been almost 2 years since astronauts had gone into space. Three astronauts had died during a test of Apollo 1 on January 27, 1967, and NASA had stopped human spaceflight while the accident was investigated and the problems fixed. 3 months after the Apollo 1 fire, a Soviet cosmonaut died on the first flight of their new Soyuz spacecraft. The public honestly wondered if sending people to the moon was really possible. This film, The Flight of Apollo 7, documents the 11-day mission in Earth orbit. It was produced by NASA shortly after the successful return of the first humans in space after the loss of four brave explorers from two different countries. Here it is as it happened.
During a rainstorm on the morning of October 22, 1968, in the Atlantic Ocean, the United States completed one of its most remarkably successful tests yet of man and machine in space. But this was only the ending. It was on a clear morning almost 11 days earlier at the Kennedy Space Center's Launch Pad 34 in Florida that we witnessed the beginning of the first manned mission in the United States Apollo program to land astronauts on the moon. The purpose of the flight of Apollo 7 could be stated very simply: prove that the spacecraft command and service modules would function properly in space long enough to carry men to the moon and back. Accomplishing this was considerably less simple. It meant showing that a brand new spacecraft, far more complicated than its predecessors, would operate so well it could be trusted to take men well beyond near-Earth orbit. The astronauts were spacecraft commander Walter Schirra and pilots Don Eisley and Walter Cunningham. The Kennedy Space Center had spent long days in preparation and checkout, working toward a launch time which had been set for months. It was not by chance that Apollo 7 lifted off only 2¾ minutes after the appointed moment.
5, 4, ignition, GRR.
Marshall Space Flight Center had spent years directing development and testing of the Saturn 1B launch vehicle, and it was not by chance that Apollo 7 was placed almost exactly on its planned trajectory into orbit about the Earth.
You've got speed, Apollo 7.
Thrust is okay.
Roger thrust.
Roll. Roger roll.
Very early in the flight, the general pattern of go for Apollo 7 was established in a conversation between the spacecraft and mission control at the manned spacecraft center in Houston, Texas.
Right on the old button.
Very good.
Flag booster.
Go.
We appear we may be slightly marginal on rocks. We'll keep
it. Okay, stand by.
Cut off. J2, cut off.
Beautiful.
Fido.
Flight Fido, we're go.
Go across the board.
TMC looks good, flight.
25553. H dot is minus 4 balls, 1.
Across the board,
Captain. We have you go for orbit. You're go for orbit.
Apollo 7 was also go for an exhaustive series of tests of its worthiness in space. One of the first things which had to be learned was whether the astronauts could control the spacecraft combined with the S-4B Saturn stage. A very similar thing would have to be done during the early phases of a lunar mission. The answer was not long in coming.
signal destination. 3, 2, 1, mark. S4B test complete. Beautiful.
That was outstanding, right?
Real fine, though. Outstanding.
Next, the spacecraft and S4B stage were separated. The question now was whether the astronauts could turn their spacecraft around and control it to the degree required for future physical link-ups with equipment in space. For this, too, would have to be done in the lunar flight.
Thrusting.
And again, the answer was yes.
Was it a little flight just like Gemini?
Something that will not be seen in the lunar flight or in any other forthcoming Apollo mission were the panels at the top of the S4B stage. They will simply be jettisoned in the future, but they drew comment in Apollo 7.
And the slot panel at the top, left and bottom are opened at, I would guess, to be about a 45 degree angle, and the slot panel on the right is just opened, though, maybe 30 degrees at the very best.
Roger. Looks like you're looking at a four-jawed angry alligator.
Apollo 7 escorted its spent S4B stage through space for perhaps 30 minutes, then departed.
That's a bigger one, Tom.
Rated now?
Yes.
It's absolutely beautiful here.
The following day, Apollo 7 burned its spacecraft propulsion system for the first two times in the mission and returned to its four-jawed alligator, which was now angrier than ever.
Apollo 7 Houston, how close are you now?
We're close to about 70 feet. It's tumbling rather wildly, so we're trying to stay away from it.
Roger, understand.
Bring your copy, Jack, go.
Okay, separation.
In this maneuver, Apollo 7 had accomplished the first rendezvous of the program, and in so doing had proven capable of meeting still another requirement for lunar flight.
1618. +1221.
Then, as we were to see in some of the most dramatic film ever returned from space, the crew would settle down to a weightless life in a spacecraft with four times more room than Gemini. There would be a host of other tests under a host of other conditions. The equipment and systems required to sustain men's lives, to guide and control and propel the spaceship, to provide electric power, to communicate with those on Earth, would time and again prove their mettle. The propulsion system, for example, was burned eight times, and it behaved perfectly every time. The crew worked with a telescope and a sextant, taking landmark and star sightings for navigation, as will be required for lunar flight. And they discovered on occasion that water particles which had been dumped overboard could be confused with stars. Care will have to be taken to avoid this confusion on future flights. All in all, though, problems were minor and generally were readily overcome or solved. The spacecraft almost seemed to grow stronger as the days went by. But Apollo 7 was as much a test of man as of machine, and human errors were not taken lightly.
Apollo 7, Houston, we acknowledge the error on the ground here.
Okay, I'd like to have the ground get to work and look at the sleep cycles.
The error had led to an interruption of a sleep period for the astronauts, who were understandably irritated after days of hard work. It was imperative that this situation be remedied.
Houston, understand.
There were also those problems to which man is susceptible but cannot control, like the common cold.
Very good. I got a couple small items for you. Wally took a couple of an Actifed. Wells took one Actifed only. He feels fine. He just got a little stuffy headphones. And I put some nose grease in mine because my nostrils are a little dry. Decided it smells good.
As the cold spread to all three astronauts, doctors feared that there might be discomfort, even pain, with eardrums as pressure increased during re-entry. The astronauts were able to cope with the problem, however, by taking decongestants and holding their noses and blowing to equalize re-entry pressures. Always before, we've had to be content with merely listening to our astronauts during their flights. In Apollo 7, through the medium of television, we could actually see them in space for the first time and become better acquainted with weightless life aboard a spacecraft.
You're picking up, I can read it now, just a minute. It says, from that lovely Apollo something, you guys should write.
Apollo room. High atop everything. High atop everything.
Looks good. I can see Wally Hamlet now. Don has a smile on his face, and there's Walt.
Down the Gulf Coast.
Okay, what's the next one? A little closer, Wally. Says keep those cards coming.
Cards and letters coming in.
Coming in, folks. It's loud and clear.
Roger, good morning to everyone in television land. You're looking at the right-hand portion of the main display console. In the upper left-hand portion of your view, you would see the instrument that has to do with the cryogenics that are used to power the fuel cells and provide breathing oxygen to the spacecraft.
As the flight of Apollo 7 proceeded day by day, confidence in men and equipment grew. The astronauts became accustomed to their home high atop everything. They had a chance to evaluate it as a place to live and work in space.
Set. Set. Is that all?
There was a chance to photograph Hurricane Gladys, which raked across Florida and headed out into the Atlantic. There was a chance to photograph areas of the Earth not previously pictured from space. For example, the coast of Chile and the Andes mountain range. The crew could evaluate such things as the importance of exercising. The quality of sleeping arrangements, the palatability of food, seemingly small items, but things of essential importance in a lunar mission. They even recorded the preparation of a drink for a meal.
We have comm at Australia.
By the time Apollo 7 entered its 11th day in space, it had exceeded the time required for a flight to the moon and back. It was also well on its way to accomplishing all planned objectives and more. Apollo 7 was called 101% successful. On the morning of October 22, 1968, Apollo 7 began its final revolution, the 163rd. At approximately 259 hours and 39 minutes after liftoff, the spacecraft propulsion system was burned for the final time, and Apollo 7 headed home to Earth. From motion picture film recorded during an earlier unmanned Apollo mission, we get some idea what the trip back through the atmosphere was like. In less than an hour after touchdown in the Atlantic Ocean, the flight crew emerged from helicopters which had brought them to the recovery ship, the carrier USS Essex. And the next manned Apollo flight can be undertaken with confidence that our brand new spacecraft is, as Commander Walter Schirra reported, a magnificent flying machine.
Four days after the return of Apollo 7, the Soviets successfully launched Soyuz 3 with one cosmonaut on board. The race to the moon was back on, and NASA rose to the challenge with Apollo 8. That documentary next time on As It Happened, How We Went to the Moon. I'm Doris Dow at the NASA Lunar Science Institute.
Are you getting a TV picture now, Houston?
Neil, yes, we are getting a TV picture.
You're in
our
field with you now.
That's
one small step for man,
one giant
leap for mankind.